Good morning and welcome to another episode of Oral Pathology 360. Today we have a basics one, and that sort of follows what someone as illustrious and a genius of our time like Elon Musk, who says you have to build knowledge like a tree from the trunk out. And for us in the oral pathology section, where square inch by square inch we have more interesting and complex structures than I think any other part of the body. And because of that, we need to really understand the basics. And today we are going to deal with basics of one of the most interesting organs, in fact, that is our salivary glands. I'm Dr. Mandana Donahue, and this is coming to you from Oral Pathology 360 and Oral Pathology India. Today we have with us Dr. Nandan and Dr. Pavan Kulkarni, who are going to be talking about the clinico-pathological profile of salivary gland neoplasms. Professor Nandan is the head at Department of Dental Sciences, Akamine Institute, and he has multiple publications. He's conducted the 13th National PG Convention, which many enjoyed. Scientific convener for the IAOMP National Conference held at Hyderabad, and he is the treasurer of the IAOMP, that is our Indian Association of Oral and Maxillofacial Pathology. We also have Professor Pavan Kulkarni, who also is from the same institute. He has mentored lots of students for various PG entrance examinations. He has numerous publications and also published a book on viva voce in oral pathology, so I can imagine that the students will already be knowing him really very well. We also have with us Dr. Anuradha, who is the professor and HOD of the St. Joseph Dental College in Andhra Pradesh, and she is going to be moderating the session. We also have another expert with us, Dr. Priya, and yes, this is, everybody is here. We also have, of course, Dr. Bhavna, who had been away for a short while, but she is back helping. And actually, Dr. Bhavna and Dr. Priya are literally the backbones of this. They helped me throughout. And that's really nice of them. And it's good to have both of them here with us again today. So with that and that small introduction, of course, there's also one more thing. For all those who are joining us from around the world on YouTube, please put your questions on the chat and we will address them as in the order that they start. Now, without any more delay, I shall pass it on to Dr. Nandan. Dr. Nandan, please take over.
Good morning, ma'am.
Good morning. Welcome.
Thank you so much for the opportunity, ma'am. Hope it is audible and visible, ma'am.
Yes, yes, it is. Yes.
I'll start sharing the screen, ma'am.
Yes, please.
Good morning, everyone. Hope had a good New Year and Christmas. Happy New Year to you all. And we'll be talking about, I must thank Dr. Mandana, ma'am, for giving us the opportunity for this, for presentation. We'll be talking about salivary gland neoplasms and clinico-pathological profile of salivary gland neoplasms. Me, myself, and Dr. Pavan Kulkarni, my other colleague from Kamineni Institute of Dental Sciences. We'll be talking about the classification of salivary gland neoplasms and our experiences and the small references at the end. The salivary gland tumors are a very difficult area in diagnostic pathologies as under practice. The classification of salivary gland neoplasms are made in a very different criteria. As such, there is no accepted, totally accepted, universally accepted classification yet in salivary gland neoplasms. There are so many classifications have been put forward many authors, but most accepted ones are Armed Forces Institute of Pathology and World Health Organization. These classifications are made on cell origin, cell type is or involved, and the behavior of the lesion, and morphological classifications, morphological appearance of the cell. On the other basis of classifications are cytogenic abnormalities, morphometry, and flow cytometry. These classifications of salivary gland tumors are never been static. It is a dynamic process. As the advancement in research and technology, there is a lot of emphasis are being made and reclassifications are made. The basis of understanding of the disease has improved due to this advancement in the research. It is important to appreciate the cell organization, cell types and cell differentiations, and materials synthesized by the salivary gland tumors. The many histogenic concepts have been evolved for the classification of and pathogens of salivary gland tumors. They're basically basal reserve cell theory, pluripotent unicellular reserve cell theory, semi-pluripotent bicellular reserve cell theory, which is refined by Batsakis, and it was proposed in 1971, and multicellular theory. The most accepted hypothesis is semi-pluripotential bicellular reserve cell theory hypothesis. The Batsakis has improvised it, and he has stated that luminal and myoepithelial cells are instrumental in progression of salivary gland tumors, and bicellular constitution is recognized in salivary gland tumors. This picture shows you the basic structure of the salivary gland tumors, and the second picture will represent the the origin of the lesion. The adenoid cystic carcinoma, polymorphous low-grade adenocarcinoma, basal cell carcinoma, and pleomorphic adenoma will be arising from the intercalated duct reserve cells. Whereas salivary duct carcinoma, mucoepidermoid carcinoma, and adenocarcinoma, not otherwise specified, primary squamous cell carcinoma, or excretory duct arising from the excretory duct reserve cells. This is a small introduction of histogenesis. If I have to speak about histogenesis, it will be another description, and we have to confine only to the histogenesis and morphogenesis. So we'll confine only to the classification alone. I'll be talking only the basis of classification. So this picture shows you the basal cell and your myoepithelial cell participation in salivary gland neoplasms. The pleomorphic adenoma, as example, luminar, acinar, and myoepithelial cells will be involved, and whereas myoepithelioma, myoepithelial, and rarely luminal cells involved. So most of these tumors are usually not arising from the single cell, so there's additions. Usually bicellular or pluripotent cells will be there be arising from. So coming on to the classification of the salivary gland tumors, there are many classifications put forward. Most accepted ones are WHO and, as I told you, Atlas of Tumor Pathology by Armed Forces Institute of Pathology. So various classification put forward, various authors and institutes. They are the first one is in 1954, Foot and Fragile, and that is by it is a part of Armed Forces Institute of Pathology. And in 1971 and in 1974 again second fascicle of Armed Forces Institute of Pathology by Thackeray and Lucas. Whereas Batsakis in 1971, Siffert and colleagues in 1976, whereas Elise and Ockler have reclassified Armed Forces Institute of Pathology, Atlas of Tumor Pathology, Salivary Gland Tumors in 1990 and 1996. Whereas Gary Elise have reclassified them in 2008 again. This is about Armed Forces Institute of Pathology, whereas WHO has released 4 editions till date, one in 1972, 1991, and 2005 and 2017. The WHO initiated the process of classification in 1952, which is published in almost 20 years later in 1972. Whereas 1952, they've initiated and they're published in 1972. This is Foote and Rajal as the first classified the salivary gland tumors as a part of tumor Atlas of Tumor Pathology, Fascicle 1 for Armed Forces Institute of Pathology. Whereas WHO has published 4 editions till date, 1972 and 1991, 2005 and 2017 to the latest. In 1972 has 10 entities of tumors, whereas 1991 there are 39 entities, and 2005 it has come down to 37, whereas 2017 33 entities alone. So what has happened in these things, the WHO has included some of the tumor-like lesions also, which is not a really a tumor or epithelial or mesenchymal in origin. And epithelium, whereas coming on to the classification of WHO, usually salivary gland tumors are classified is a confluence of mesenchymal, epithelial and lymphoid also. So it makes diverse, very diverse cells. Histomorphological patterns. And they've not emphasized clinically, or it has not given a clinician a very good classification of salivary gland neoplasm by Foote and Rajal, which includes 5 benign tumors, 4 carcinomas and 6 subtypes of adenocarcinomas, which is as a part of Fascicle 1, as I told you, the tumor of Atlas of Tumor Pathology by Armed Forces Institute of Pathology. Whereas in benign, you have 5 variants, whereas 5 variants of tumors, 4 carcinomas, 6 subtypes of adenocarcinomas, and malignant and benign, only this basis have been there. There is no inclusion of any of this connective tissue tumors in this, except benign lymphoepithelial lesion. Lymph has been covered here. It's coming on to 74, again, a second fascicle of AFIP. They have covered sarcomas here, and mucoepidermoid tumor, eosinophilic cell tumor have been added, and metastatic tumor has been added here, and other many tumors have been added by AFIP here. Whereas in Batsa case in 1971, there are a lot of inclusions, unclassified myoepithelial undifferentiated carcinomas have been included here. This is Siffert's classification in 1986, and Ellis and Ochler, third fascicle. In 1990, Ellis and Ochler have classified one basic classification, which is based on grading. Mucoepidermoid carcinomas are being graded as low grade, intermediate grade, and high grade. That is useful for clinical pathologists, clinicians, and for the prognosis of the disease. And this classification included mesenchymal neoplasms, benign and sarcomas and malignant lymphomas, metastatic tumors, non-neoplastic tumor-like conditions also been included here by Ellis and Ochler for AFIP Fascicle 3 in 1996. This coming on to WHO in 1972. This is proposed by Thackeray and Sobin in 1972, which is started in 1952. They have epithelial tumors and carcinomas, and they have 5 tumors and non-epithelial unclassified tumors, allied conditions also been included here. The benign lymphoepithelial lesion, silosis and oncocytosis all been included here. But a second edition of classification and comparatively from 1972 to 91, the classification represent improvements of its predecessor 1972. The mucoepidermoid tumor and eosinophilic cell tumor have been renamed as carcinomas due to their aggressiveness, and WHO recognized 6 different adenomas, which has increased to 9 in 1991. But 5 different carcinomas was there in 1972, which has increased to 16 in the revision of salivary gland neoplasms. This is based on distant clinical pathological patterns and morphological histomorphological appearance and behavior patterns. So this is 1991 classification. I have slightly included almost all the things which may not be available in some of the recent textbooks, the smaller textbooks. I have included almost all the things for 1991 classification. And 2005 came up. The 2005 World Health Organization classification of salivary gland tumors comprises of 10 benign and 23 malignant tumors of epithelial origin, and 4 non-epithelial and secondary tumors. The behavior has not really been addressed in this classification. So this is a paucity of this particular classification, and the TNM staging would have been more helpful for the clinician to plan the treatment. So this is again reclassified by WHO in 2017. The changes what has been made, I'll be talking about. The 4th edition of 2017 classification of salivary gland tumors is based on histopathology. It has 22 carcinomas, 11 benign tumors, 4 non-neoplastic epithelial lesions, 3 benign soft tissue entities, and mucosa-associated lymphoma, tissue lymphoma, making one of the most extensive classification of the tumors by WHO. What are the additions here? The MASC, mammary analog secretory carcinoma, has been renamed as secretory carcinoma in this edition. The sclerosing polycystic adenosis, it's a controversial inclusion here, because the polycystic adenosis does not fall into the benign or the malignant entities. So it's a controversial entity here. And polymorphous low-grade adenocarcinoma has been cut off to polymorphous adenocarcinoma. This makes histopathologist difficulties here. We have to really think, if you have a smaller tissue, and then we have to, it is very difficult or troublesome for a diagnosis of poly, differentiating it from adenoid cystic carcinoma and pleomorphic adenoma. So we require some sort of diagnostic markers for these. So that makes histopathology difficult, histopathologists difficult in very small bits of tissues. So that is about polymorphous low-grade adenocarcinoma turning into polymorphous adenocarcinoma. But as coming on to intraductal carcinomas, they were previously cribriform cystadenocarcinoma, low-grade salivary duct carcinoma, salivary duct carcinoma in situ. And poorly differentiated carcinomas, whereas in 2005, it was called as undifferentiated carcinoma. Here it includes poorly differentiated carcinomas include small bowel carcinoma and neuroendocrine. And large small cell carcinomas, neuroendocrine carcinomas have been included here. And adenocarcinoma NOS, not otherwise specified, as merged cystadenocarcinoma, mucinous adenocarcinoma, papillary cystadenocarcinoma, all these came into one single entity. But a cystadenocarcinoma, mucinous adenocarcinoma has been removed as separate entity. Whereas lymphadenoma, sebaceous and again the controversial or contradicting own statements by WHO in 2005 and 1991 and 2017. Pleomorphic adenocarcinoma, metastasizing pleomorphic carcinoma, histomorphologically appears same in the secondary site also. But it was considered as malignant variant before, malignant variant into 2005 and classification. And now it has been made as benign variant. So there's a contradicting statement in 2005 and 2017. Whereas coming on to carcinoma ex pleomorphic adenoma, what the WHO states right now is we have to emphasize which cell has been involved, because there is, it is a pleomorphic adenoma, which cell has been involved, that has to be very clearly mentioned in the biopsies or the biopsy reports. And sile adenoma papilliferum has been removed from the ductal papillomas. And inverted ductal papilloma, ductal papillomas, which all the papillomas, all which were together in 2005, has been made a single entity now. And other non-neoplastic epithelial lesions, the new categories are sclerosing, polycystic adenosis, nodular oncocytic hyperplasia, lymphoepithelial sialadenitis, intercalated duct hyperplasia. The entities which have been removed from the classification is, as I told you, polymorphous low grade has been removed, and cribriform cyst adenocarcinoma, interductal carcinoma, low grade sebaceous and non-sebaceous lymphadenomas, and they have been grouped under lymphadenoma singly right now. So the WHO classification from 72 to 2017 mostly concentrated on histomorphogenesis or histomorphological differentiation of the cells. And none of them are really concentrated on the advancing research, and they have not utilized the markers to include in. And grading of the tumor, which has been done by Elise and Ockler in 1990, would have, and TNM staging is being done, if that had been added here, and that would have been more helpful to the clinician rather than based only on histomorphogenesis. And utilization of the markers have been not clearly mentioned in the 2017 classification. This is my personal opinion. These are my references. Dr. Pawan will take over about our experiences.
While you're just doing the changeover with Dr. Pawan, I would like to make one announcement to everyone on YouTube. I think you're having a little difficulty with the clarity of the text. There is a setting that you can adjust within YouTube to increase the quality, because the quality is by default set at 250, you need to increase it to 700. Once you do that, you'll get a much clearer picture on the texts. Yeah, please go on. Sorry for the interruption.
No problem, ma'am. Just give us a second, ma'am. I'll just change over.
Good morning, ma'am. Good morning, everyone.
Yeah, good morning. Please start.
I'll be in this session, I'll be talking about our experience about the salivary gland tumors in at our institution. So I'll be giving a brief history about the patient and about the clinical histopathological images and the differential diagnosis we can talk about. So let me start with the first case. I'm sorry for some technical hiccups here. This is where the patient presented to us with a complaint of a swelling on the palate since 4 months. It was a slowly
Dr.
growing
Pawan,
swelling.
Your screen is showing your folder. It's not showing your slides. Your screen is showing, I think, your document folder.
1 second, ma'am. Now is it fine, ma'am?
No, not yet. I think just stop sharing your screen. First open the PowerPoint and then again start a new share.
Okay. Share screen. Yeah, ma'am.
No, open your PowerPoint and keep first. Don't worry, take your time. In the meanwhile,
sorry.
No worries. In the meanwhile, let me see who is with us today. So we have Dr. Akriti, we have Dr. Uma Devi, we have Tanaz Vandukola, who is my niece and who is actually behind getting me to do this. So she is watching today. And that's very nice. Hi, Tanaz. Then we have Dr. Varun and we have, of course, Dr. Priya, who is with us. We have Dr. Rashmi Medgood and I saw Dr. Selvi, Dr. Suchitra. Yes. Hello, everybody. And of course, everyone who may not have put in a comment, so we don't really know they're there. It's wonderful having all of you all here. I'd like to know if how many postgraduate students are there. Can you all put in some comments saying you're a postgraduate and from where? That would be very nice. Since this is really for you guys, so it'd be nice to see that. Oh, and Dr. Nandini also has joined us. Hi, Nandini. Okay, I think you have got your presentation now. Yes, okay. Yes, you can start.
This is the first case where a 27-year-old male complained, presented with a complaint in the palate, right of the palate, since 4 months. The swelling was slowly growing. Biopsy of the case was done. Histopathology showed, in this image, we can see numerous duct-like structures, which are of varying sizes, small and large. And we can appreciate that the lumen of those ducts is filled with some eosinophilic material. Eosinophilic coagulum, and in between those ducts, we can see presence of cells at the scanner view, things which you can appreciate at this. When we went on to higher magnification, the scanner could be appreciated, this duct-like structures with eosinophilic coagulum. Here we can appreciate two things, the presence of a luminal cells, which are lining the duct-like structures, and in between the duct, we can see some abluminal cells. So which are having the clear appearance, abluminal cells at places. So in this view, you can see duct-like structures, luminal and abluminal cells. In the other view, other areas, we can see presence of loose myxoid areas, myxoid structures, loosely, delicately collagenous stroma. This is another area of the same case, hyalinized areas can be seen. The same case with the presence of fat-like tissue or lipoid areas could be seen. And we can appreciate here the same thing, that is duct-like structures, presence of luminal and abluminal cells. At focal area, we could even see presence of squamous metaplasia. We could see the keratinizing epithelium. We can appreciate in this field even the lipoid areas. So with this, we went to give a differential diagnosis of two things, pleomorphic adenoma and myoepithelioma. So before going into the final diagnosis, let us see briefly how are these two different histologically. Pleomorphic adenoma will show presence of two types of cells, that is the luminal cells and abnormal cells. Abnormal cells are the myoepithelial cells. Whereas in myoepithelioma, it will show predominantly myoepithelial cell population. There is no epithelial cell here, that is luminal cell component. In pleomorphic adenoma, you will see proliferation in the form of ducts, sheets, and cords. However, in myoepithelioma, the presence of ducts are very less. It's less than 5% of the ductal elements can be seen. In pleomorphic adenoma, we'll see presence of chondromyxoid areas. That is myxoid areas, loose areas, and chondroid-like areas. It is cartilage-like areas. Whereas in myoepithelioma, we can't appreciate these. This is a very important structure, that is chondromyxoid stroma. So, but in our case, we could see presence of duct-like structures. We could see presence of myxoid areas. We could see presence of lipoid areas, and we could see presence of keratinizing epithelium. Based on all these things, we went on to give a final histopathological diagnosis as pleomorphic adenoma. But it says that the standard, the most important histological criteria for diagnosis of pleomorphic adenoma is chondromyxoid stroma. That's very characteristic. And one more important thing I would just like to appreciate here, the residents, it's important for them to understand. If we see here, the abnormal cells or the myoepithelial cells, they're not restricted, or there is no boundary between them and the stroma. There's no clear-cut demarcation. They are melting. We can appreciate in this image. They are melting into the stroma. So presence of this melting type of growth pattern, that is presence of the entering of these or proliferation of these myoepithelial cells into the stroma, presence of ducts, myxoid areas, then lipoid areas, we give a diagnosis as pleomorphic adenoma. I'd like to add one more pick here. What is important here for the residents, they can see here chondroid areas, which was not seen in our case. So there's a chondroid or cartilage-like area, which we can see. All these things, chondroid areas, myxoid areas, the lipoid areas, even we see sometimes osseous areas, all these are because of the metaplasia by the myoepithelial cells or the abnormal cells. Moving on to the second case, a 68-year-old male smoker presented with a complaint of a slowly going swelling near the angle of the mandible. So the swelling was restricted only near the angle of the mandible. That's an important point here to be noted. Pardon me for the histopathological image here. So here in this scanner view, what we can see here is we can see some cystic areas, cystic spaces. We can see some papillary folds, finger-like projections, and we can see some lymphoid areas, which are darkly stained. Okay, those are lymphoid areas. So in this, we can see papillary areas, lymphoid areas, and cystic areas. So when we went on for a higher magnification, we can see the epithelium, which is double layer. If we have got an inner layer, there is inner layer and outer layer. And all these layers have got an abundant eosinophilic cytoplasm. And here we can see the central cystic space, which is there. And we can appreciate here some area, there is a eosinophilic material within that, within cystic area. And down, we can see the presence of the lymphoid areas, lymphoid follicles. When we want a higher magnification, we can appreciate the granular cytoplasm in the one of the layers of the epithelium, which they are eosinophilic granular cytoplasm, which show that they are oncocytic cells, oncocytic in origin. So it's a very characteristic, straightforward diagnosis. It's not a hard diagnosis to give. Cystic areas, double layered epithelium, oncocytic layers within the oncocytic cells within the epithelium, supported by the lymphoid stroma. We could give a direct, straightforward diagnosis as Warthin's tumor. Okay, so here, if we correlate here, Warthin's tumor, the history that was is mainly a male patient, and a patient was a smoker. So that is what smoking is implicated usually. And it was a slowly growing swelling in the angle of the mandible. So it was a tumor arising from the tail of the parotid gland, Warthin's tumor, this particular case. Moving on to the third case. So where a 62-year-old female patient complained of a swelling which was slowly growing in the upper lip. So here the swelling was in the upper lip. Biopsy was done for the case. In this field, we can see presence of the basaloid cells in the scanner view. And those cells, which we can appreciate in a higher view. So here at this view, we can see some basaloid cells which are arranged in the form of trabeculae. The pattern is important. In a scanner view, what we should appreciate in any salivary gland neoplasms is the pattern. In higher magnifications, we should appreciate the cytology. So here in the scanner, we can appreciate the interconnecting trabeculae. And you can see the connective tissue, which is entrapped because of this trabeculae, in between the trabeculae. We went on for a higher magnification. We could see here two things. We can appreciate here. The cell, the lining, the one which is there is the peripheral layer. That is where it is the tall columnar or to cuboidal. It is cuboidal to columnar. And it is having a hyperchromatic nuclei. We can appreciate that. However, the cells in the center, we can see here, they are having a vesicular nucleus. We can appreciate, I'll show you one more image for this. Yes, we can appreciate here that the peripheral cells, which are palisading, the nuclei at the same level, they've got a hyperchromatic nuclei, and the central cells are having a round nuclei, and it is a vesicular type of nuclei. So here we can appreciate two types of cells. So with this histological images, we went on to give a histopathological differential diagnosis as basal cell adenoma. So here basal cell adenoma will have basaloid cells, peripheral palisading, central vesicular cells, and sharp demarcation between the epithelium and connective tissue. This is a very, very important point. Why? Because sometimes in pleomorphic adenoma, we have just discussed now that there won't be any sharp demarcation between the epithelial cells, myoepithelial cells, and the connective tissue stroma. That is melting type of growth pattern. Or according to Batsaki, Batsaki says that swarm of bees appearance, which is seen in pleomorphic adenoma. But in basal cell adenoma, we don't see such pattern. There is a sharp demarcation between the epithelium and the connective tissue. Pleomorphic adenoma was another differential diagnosis, but in the present case, there was no chondroid area, there was no myxoid area, and there was lack of melting type of growth pattern, which we could rule out the pleomorphic adenoma. And the very important point of all the residents should understand this: whenever we are adding any differential diagnosis, two things should be kept in the mind. Why are we adding into the differential diagnosis list, and how are we going to rule it out? How are we going to rule it out? So by ruling out that there is no chondroid areas, myxoid areas, and no melting type of growth pattern, we can see this. We can rule out this. This is not a pleomorphic adenoma. Basal cell adenocarcinoma, but in the present case, there was no infiltrative nature. There was no perirenal invasion. There was no vascular invasion. And there was lack of cellular ERTPA, except for the peripheral cells, which showed palisading hyperchromatic nuclei. Otherwise, there were no any other prominent features of cellular ERTPA. With that, we could rule out the basal cell adenocarcinoma. Adenoid cystic carcinoma was also added, but again, the same thing here. There was no infiltrative nature, no vascular invasion, no perineal invasion, and no cellular ERTPA. So that ruled out the adenoid cystic carcinoma. So based on these, so when we go back and see the images here, yes, the characteristic that fits to our diagnosis, basal cell adenoma, because peripheral cells and the central cells which having a vesicular nuclei. So this was a trabecular type of basal cell adenoma, which is a very unique thing. We have reported this because usually we tend to see the solid type of basal cell adenoma. So this was a case of a trabecular type of basal cell adenoma. Usually the basal cell adenomas are more common in the parotid as far as the major salivary glands are there. In the minor salivary glands, it usually involves the upper lip and buccal mucosa. So this was a case in the upper lip. Moving on to the fourth case, a 72-year-old female patient presented with a complaint of slowly growing swelling in the preauricular region. So in front of the ear, there was a swelling which was slowly growing. A female patient, 72-year-old. And most of these salivary gland neoplasms, as far as they are involving the parotid, the clinical presentation tends to be almost same or similar. Why? Because most of these benign, they will be usually involving the parotid gland. They'll be slowly growing. So what is most important gold standard is the histopathology, which will give us the diagnosis. So in this histopathological images of this case, we could see lobular architecture. We can appreciate here the septa. The septa is dividing the lesional tissue into lobules, and that septa is fibrous as well. I'll just go to the higher magnification. So we can see here that the lobules are made up of basically polyhedral cells. We can see here the cells which are polyhedral. They have a distinct cell border and they have got a eosinophilic cytoplasm. I'll go to the higher view here. We can see magnification. The nuclei, that's the most important thing we can appreciate here, the very important thing here, that the nuclei here is in the center or in the periphery. We can see vesicular nuclei at places. We can see in the corner here, right side, it is having a hyperchromatic nuclei. So this, we can appreciate this point to be kept in mind, that it is having a abundant granular eosinophilic cytoplasm, polyhedral cells, sheets, having a vesicular nuclei, and also at places hyperchromatic nuclei. So with this, we get to get differential diagnosis as oncocytoma, where you see sheets of oncocytes. Oncocytes are nothing but the cells which are having a eosinophilic granular cytoplasm, and electron microscopic studies have showed that these granules are mitochondria. Actually, they are mitochondria. So in this oncocytoma, you'll also see focal areas of cellular ertipia. We also considered oncocytosis. We have to understand here a very important basic difference between oncocytoma and oncocytosis. Oncocytoma is a benign neoplasm arising from oncocytes, whereas oncocytosis is a reactive process. It's a hyperplastic lesion. It's not a neoplasm. In this, we can see focal areas of oncocytes within the normal salivary gland tissue. Okay, at focal area, we can see the oncocytes. Otherwise, everywhere else, we'll have the normal salivary gland tissue. Oncocytic carcinoma, why we kept in the mind is because of the ertipia. Because as it was an incisional biopsy, so we kept into mind even oncocytic carcinoma, but there was no vascular invasion, there was no infiltrative nature. And other than hyperchromatism, in the present case, we didn't have any kind of other features of ertipia, such as abnormal mitotic figures or pleomorphism. So with this, we could rule out even the oncocytic carcinoma. So based on this, we went on to give a final diagnosis as oncocytoma. Moving on to the fifth case, a 60-year-old female complains of a swelling in the right side of the palate since 9 months. If you can appreciate in the image, the swelling or the nodule is having an ulcer. You can see there that ulcer is healed. It is healing. The histopathology showed presence of, we can see presence of row of cells here, which are lining the cystic spaces. Those row of cells, which are large cells, which are nothing but your mucus cells. And these the cytoplasm of these mucus cells is basophilic and it is abundant. In the other areas, we can also see here certain cells having epidermoid and intermediate cell-like pattern. At the higher magnification, we can appreciate the same things in scanner. There's mucus cells and we can see the epidermoid areas. This is a focal area where we could see the epidermoid areas, islands of epidermoid areas. Based on this presence of, and this is a representative photos which we have, I'm showing here. Actually abundant, there was a cystic space. There was abundant cystic space. There's a lot of mucus cells and focal areas of these epidermoid cells. Based on this, we went on to give a diagnosis as low-grade mucoepidermoid carcinoma. And it's very important for us to differentiate whether it's a low-grade, intermediate grade or high-grade, because it determines the prognosis and treatment plan for the surgeons. And how do we classify, how do we grade this is based on these histological features. We are going to consider the cystic component, neural invasion, necrosis, mitosis, and all these things. In a low grade, we find more of cystic component and we find more of mucus cells. As we move on to higher grades, the cystic component will be less. Rather, the solid component of epidermoid cells will be more. You see a lot of epidermoid cell proliferation. You see a lot of necrosis, nerve invasion, anaplasia in a higher grade. So a higher grade mucoepidermoid carcinoma, sometimes it mimics squamous cell carcinoma. There comes the role of histochemistry. Why? Because under light microscope, we may not be able to appreciate mucus cells at places. So what happens is a high-grade mucoepidermoid carcinoma might mimic a squamous cell carcinoma histologically. But if we use a special stain for mucin, such as your Alshin blue or mucicarmin stain, we can appreciate focal areas of these mucin as well as mucus cells. So that helps to differentiate that this is a high-grade mucoepidermoid carcinoma and not a squamous cell carcinoma. But that's a different issue or story different. But this present case, what we have reported was a classic case of low-grade mucoepidermoid carcinoma. Moving on to the sixth case, where a 24-year-old patient, female patient, complained of a swelling on the right side of the palate since 4 months. Swelling was slowly growing, painless, and persistent swelling. CT scan of this case, we can appreciate here in the 1617 region, there is a buccolingual cortical expansion.
Dr. Pawan,
see here,
sorry,
small duct-like or tubule-like structures. And
Dr.
those...
Pawan, can I interrupt? I think your video is having a little too much of buffering. Can you turn your video off? I think that will give a better speed to the presentation.
Yes, ma'am. It's coming. My internet connection is unstable. I'll just come on. I'll put escape this, ma'am.
Yeah. And
this
just,
could be fine, ma'am.
Yeah. No, basically just... No. You keep your presentation as it is. What you do is your own video you turn off. There is that video sign down there, no? On the Zoom, there is a video, there's a camera. Yeah, just turn that off.
Yeah, ma'am.
Click on it and it will...
Ma'am.
Yeah. You can see that video sign, a video camera at the bottom of the Zoom or maybe on top, depending on how it is arranged.
One second. Okay. Yeah, stop video.
Yeah, stop your video. Don't stop your share. Stop your video.
Yeah, I've kept the stop video.
Okay, now you can continue with your presentation. You have to go back to the presentation view, but with your slide.
You need to go to again.
No, see, your presentation has gone to just the, you know, the... it's not on the presentation view. I just click on that hourglass down so you go back to presenter's view.
That's fine, ma'am.
Yeah, perfect. Please, sorry for the interruption.
No problem, not issue. Thank you. So this case, coming the same thing, what we can appreciate here is a lot of duct-like spaces, and we can see presence of cells. Here, I'll go to the higher magnification. We can appreciate that better. Yes, the duct-like or tubule-like structures. And we can see two layers of cells here, two layers. One which is lining exactly the ducts or lumen, and the other one which is outside. So if we can appreciate here, the ducts cells which is lining outside are the clear cells. They are the clear cells. And the cells which are lining, they have got a hyperchromatic nuclei. Other areas of the same case, we can appreciate the presence of multiple cystic spaces, which is a classical cribriform appearance. Higher view of the same, higher magnification showed presence of cystic spaces and presence of the cells which are having a hyperchromatic round nuclei, darkly stained nuclei. So in the same case, we had two types of areas, two types of patterns. One, it was showing a tubular duct-like with the presence of luminal cells and presence of abluminal cells, which are clear cells. In the other area, which was predominant, showed a lot of cribriform appearance. So with this, we went on to give a histopathological differential diagnosis of adenoid cystic carcinoma, which typically shows cribriform pattern and a tubular pattern, and it will have a hyperchromatic angular nuclei, and those cystic areas will be filled with the eosinophilic material. Even we considered epithelial myoepithelial carcinoma, Why? Mainly we considered this because even in epithelial myoepithelial carcinoma also we have biphasic pattern. Biphasic pattern means here we have the epithelial cells as well as the myoepithelial cells. The myoepithelial cells, as we know, takes different morphological appearances. It can be a clear cell, it can be a spindle cell, it can be a plasmacytoid, it can be an epitheloid. So here in the case, in the present case, histopathological case, we could see the presence of the clear cells around. But the how do we rule out this epithelial myoepithelial carcinoma? Is this epithelial myoepithelial carcinoma usually lacks cribriform pattern. If it is there also, it will be in a very focal area. But in our case, the cribriform pattern was the most abundant. Papillary cystic architecture will be seen in case of epithelial myoepithelial carcinomas. You will see papillary areas, which is typically absent in adenoid cystic carcinomas. And in the present case, we didn't see any of the papillary structures. And the epithelial myoepithelial carcinoma also contains clear myoepithelial cells. But in the usually the adenoid cystic carcinoma will contain the myoepithelial cells with darkly angulated nuclei. So this is also one more important point which made us to think of epithelial myoepithelial carcinomas. But as a whole, when we could see here, it lacked the cribriform pattern. It didn't have the papillary structure, typical papillary structure. So at this histological level, diagnosis level, we ruled out epithelial myoepithelial carcinoma. We even considered a polymorphous low-grade adenocarcinoma because it will also have different types of patterns. As the name says, suggests, polymorphous, it will have tubular, trabecular pattern, solid pattern. In the present case, we could see the areas of tubular structures and microcystic areas. But polymorphous adenocarcinoma will have a bland nuclei. It will have a cytological monotony. That means it doesn't show any hyperchromatic angular nuclei. And it will have only one type of tumor cells. It doesn't have the biphasic, typical biphasic pattern, which we just spoke about. So with this, we could rule out even the polymorphous adenocarcinoma. Basal cell adenocarcinoma was also included, but usually this also doesn't have any cribriform pattern. And a very important point to be understood is in basal cell adenocarcinoma, which is a low-grade carcinoma, which arises from basal cell adenoma usually, or it can be a de novo. We have already seen in basal cell adenoma, we have a peripheral palisading and a central cells. So that typical pattern or appearance could not be seen in this present case. So with this, we went on to give a final pathological diagnosis as adenoid cystic carcinoma. In this present case, we didn't have this typical area of perineural invasion. The PGs and the residents can appreciate here, we have a central nerve here, nerve bundle, and we are able to see presence of the proliferation of these cells, epithelial cells and myoepithelial cells around the nerve, that is perineural invasion. That makes this tumor very fast growing or rapidly spreading tumor. Moving on to the seventh case, a 40-year-old female complains of a swelling in the palate since years because the patient didn't have any particular description or when in a proper history. It is a long-standing case, but it rapidly increased in the past 1 month. So that's important thing here. The patient complained that the patient had a swelling, but it rapidly increased since the past 1 month. In the present case, when the histopathology showed here, duct-like structures, we can appreciate here, and they are having a double layered epithelium. We can see in the right image, it's very clear. We'll have two layers here, double layered. This duct-like structure was filled with the eosinophilic coagulum, and we can see the cells which are lining this duct-like structures, that is epithelial cells. And we can appreciate here the cells which are around this, that is abluminal cells. Those abluminal cells are having at places epitheloid, at places they are having clear cells, we can see here. And they are having a peripheral eccentric nucleus, eccentrically placed nucleus. Other
Dr. Pawan, can you hear me? Dr. Pavan. Dr. Pavan? Sorry, folks, we seem to have met up with some little break in the connection there. While I can actually see his share screen. Dr. Pavan, are you connected?
Ma'am, I think he has muted his mic, ma'am.
Yes, no, okay. We'll try and call them. But he should hear me. Dr. Pavan? Dr. Nandan? Dr. Anuradha, will you try and call them, please?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So, in the meanwhile,
can you hear, ma'am?
Yeah, I can hear you.
Yeah, there was some problem in this, ma'am. I'll just wait.
Okay.
Yeah. I'll just share it again.
Yeah. Yes, please.
Sorry, ma'am.
It's okay. It happens. Take your time.
It's clear, ma'am. It's clear.
Yeah, I'm not seeing your share.
One second, I'll just share it. There was some internet issue, so it got disconnected.
Yeah, no problem. So, yeah, it has, your share has started.
Yes, ma'am.
You just have to go back. Yeah, okay.
Yeah,
we're good to go.
Yeah, ma'am. This is another area where we could see these epithelial cells showing pleomorphism and abundant predominantly cells were vesicular nuclei. They were predominantly the vesicular nuclei. Other areas, this was one area which was very interesting. We could see presence of the cells which are having eccentric nuclei and those cells are having hyperchromatic darkly stained nuclei. That's a very important point that shows that they are the myoepithelial cells and they are showing features of urtipia, cellular urtipia. So, but we were not, this one we went on to give it immunohistochemistry, we want to do immunohistochemistry to prove or to confirm that what particular exactly is this. So we went on to give up, we wanted for P63 marker. Here we can appreciate the same thing which we could see in the histopathology. The cells which are around, that is avaluminal cells were positive for P63, that showed that those are myoepithelial cells. And we also went on to do immunohistochemistry with pancytokeratin. So where this pancytokeratin will show positivity for both the epithelial cells as well as the myoepithelial cells. So with this, we could find, after the as the immunohistochemistry, we thought of two these things basically, the epithelial myoepithelial carcinoma, which will typically show the double layered epithelium and the outer clear cells. And we can see presence of malignant plasma cells. Plasma cytoid cells. Plasma cytoid cells, because those are the myoepithelial cells. And so with that, that was the thing that we kept in mind, that epithelial myoepithelial carcinoma. Mucoepidermoid carcinoma was also kept in mind because thinking of clear cells, but we could not see any epidermoid and intermediate cells. So we could rule out that it's not a mucoepidermoid carcinoma. Even we thought of myoepithelial carcinoma, but in myoepithelial carcinoma, there won't be any epithelial component, which was very much evident in the present case. So there was epithelial component, luminal cells, which also showed positivity for pancytokeratin. That proved that there is a neoplasm is having a biphasic appearance, a biphasic pattern origin from epithelial component as well as myoepithelial component. Adenoid cystic carcinoma was considered in differential diagnosis because of the duct-like pattern. But the typical in adenoid cystic carcinoma, what we see, the cribriform pattern, those cystic spaces will be filled with a lot of pools of eosinophilic material, glycosaminoglycans, and all those things, which was not evident in the present case. So we could rule out the adenoid cystic carcinoma. We even included metastatic renal cell carcinoma, but we ruled out it with just considering the clear cells. Why we have added this is because this is a very important thing that residents should understand, that whenever we see clear cells, but it's a very thing which a lot of things we have, will come under differential diagnosis. One of the important thing is metastatic renal cell carcinoma. So, but the metastatic renal cell carcinoma will have a usually a lot of vascular background, and it won't have in the typical biphasic pattern, which was evident in the present case. So with this, we went on to give a final diagnosis as epithelial myoepithelial carcinoma. Moving on to the last case for today, a 62-year-old female patient, complaint of slowly going swelling in the parotid region. As I've already told you, the clinical findings are almost similar in any kind of the neoplasm salivary gland, particularly if they are involving the parotid gland and if they are benign. Okay, or sometimes even malignant also will show a slowly growing swelling. Later, it will become aggressive or rapidly growing. So this swelling, when the biopsy was done, it showed sheets of cells. Here we can see, and it is having in the scanner view, we can appreciate that it is having abundant basophilic cytoplasm and a dark nuclei, which is hyperchromatic nuclei, round nuclei. When we went on for a higher magnification, we can appreciate here the granular basophilic cytoplasm. And we can see here the eccentric nuclei. At places, the cells is having central nuclei. But the point to be understood here is two things. One is the cytoplasm is basophilic, granular, and the nucleus is round and darkly stained nucleus. In a high power view, we can appreciate the same things, that it is having granular basophilic cytoplasm with the eccentric nuclei. We can see here darkly stained nuclei. So with this, we went on to give a final pathological diagnosis as eosinic cell carcinoma, solid variant. So this eosinic cell carcinoma, interesting point about this is it's a low grade malignancy. It usually doesn't show the typical cytological features, ERTPA, features of cytological ERTPA. It usually shows the, mainly it will show the hyperchromatism. It doesn't show the abundant mitotic figures, abnormal mitotic figures or pleomorphism. So with that, we could give a diagnosis as eosinic cell carcinoma. So I'll just finish up this lecture with a brief history of a brief description about immunohistochemistry. What's its role in the diagnosis of salivary gland neoplasms? Before going into the immunohistochemistry, one thing we should understand is this immunohistochemistry will help us to come to a diagnosis or finding that this is a salivary gland in origin. It doesn't exactly help us to differentiate between the two. Many a times, this is a common thing that happens. It doesn't help us to differentiate. So always the diagnosis of salivary gland neoplasms is you have to use the morphological appearance as well as the immunohistochemistry. So these are the various markers here. We can see here the luminal cells, abluminal cells, cytokeratin, which we had used in our case. The luminal cells, which are epithelial, will show the marker positivity for the EMA, that is epithelial in origin, and carcinoembryonic antigen. Whereas the myoepithelial cells are the abluminal cells. They will be positive for SMA, calponin, muscle specific actin, and P63. So in the present case, we used pan cytokeratin and P63. And the pan cytokeratin was positive both for luminal and abluminal cells, and P63 was positive for the abluminal cells. That showed it is a participation of both epithelial as well as myoepithelial. A very important thing here, we can appreciate that GFAP, glial fibrillary acidic protein. This is a very important thing. This is one marker which is usually used nowadays commonly to show the chondroid areas, chondromatized areas, which are very typically seen in case of the pleomorphic adenoma. Those chondroid areas will be positive for GFAP. So whenever we have a confusion, because pleomorphic adenoma and myoepitheliomas are the one which are very similar, because in pleomorphic adenoma, we have one variant like myoepithelial rich pleomorphic adenoma. It's like a spectrum. So one end of the spectrum, some researchers believe that it is a myoepithelioma. So the point to be understood here, why I'm emphasizing that, is GFAP will help us to rule out, because in myoepithelial, in myoepithelioma, we don't have chondromyxoid areas. So if we have a confusion that it is a myoepithelioma or pleomorphic adenoma, we can use this marker GFAP, which will show positivity for the chondroid areas. Other markers can be used like vimentin for myoepithelial cells. Ki-67 is a proliferative marker. And this is very important. HER2 is a very important marker, which will be used usually in the diagnosis of salivary duct carcinoma. So that's very important. We can use this marker. And even the alpha amylase, which is a marker which is used for acinic cell carcinoma, because we know that acinic cell carcinoma has got serious SNR differentiation. So it will show positivity for the alpha amylase. And androgen receptor is on even positive in salivary duct carcinomas. So we have not, in our institution, we have not reported any salivary carcinoma. So, but these are the markers which can be used, like androgen receptors and HER2, for the confirmation that it is a salivary duct carcinoma. So I'll end up this talk with this flowchart. It's very important flowchart. We can understand here. I have taken it from this diagnostic histopathology. Whenever we have a salivary gland neoplasms, we have to see the tumor borders, whether it is non-infiltrative or infiltrative. Most of the benign will be non-infiltrative. Exceptions are there, which is there given that PA, pleomorphic adenoma, sometimes can have. And malignants are usually infiltrative. Then we went on, when we go on to see for the benign one, based on the cytomorphology, the benign salivary gland neoplasms can sometimes have two cell types. Like as we have discussed in the first case, pleomorphic adenoma will have two cell types. That is a luminal and abluminal. Okay, even basal cell adenoma, we have seen two cell types. That is a peripheral cells, hyperchromatic palisading cells, as well as central cells, which are the vesicular round cells. And we have one cell type in benign, that is, which is myoepithelioma, which we have seen that myoepithelioma is just a proliferation of myoepithelial cells. There is no epithelial component here. Canalicular adenomas, striated duct adenomas, all these are one cell types. And we have oncocytic benign. These oncocytic, which are typically the Warthin's tumor, which we have seen in the case, and even the oncocytoma, which are having oncocytic in origin. Coming to the malignant, we have two cell types. That is the epithelial cells or the ductal cells and the myoepithelial cells, which we have seen already the two cases, first two cases, adenoid cystic carcinoma and epithelial myoepithelial carcinoma. And one cell type in malignant, where it is having only ductal in origin, example salivary duct carcinoma, secretory carcinoma, and only arising from myoepithelial, that is myoepithelial carcinoma. So that's what we have seen, that how to differentiate between epithelial and myoepithelial carcinoma is based on the morphology, is the types of cells. So in myoepithelial carcinoma, we are able to see only one type of cell, that is a myoepithelial cell. Acinic cell carcinoma is a straightforward, we'll see only the, it's a malignancy of the serous SNR cells, differentiation. And we can also see tumors with squamous differentiation, that is mucoepidermoid carcinoma and clear cell carcinoma. So that's a very important flowchart that we should understand, which are how the different types of cells will help us to narrow down our diagnosis. Okay. Thank you, everyone. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, Dr. Pawan. Thank you, Dr. Nandan. That was a wonderful presentation. It was really very well done and very thorough. Now I just request Dr. Anuradha to start moderating the session and take the questions as in the order that they had turned up. And I think, yes, if you can stop sharing your screen now.
Yes, ma'am. We'll stop. Stop sharing.
I can start.
It was a wonderful presentation by Dr. Nandan and Pawan. The morphogenetic concepts of salivary gland tumors was well tabulated by Nandan as well as Pawan, and the approach for differential diagnosis was also fantastic. Now, coming on to the questions which have been asked by various viewers, the first was by Dr. Selvi. Is there any difference between cellular pleomorphic adenoma and myoepithelioma?
What it says is that the cellular pleomorphic adenoma, we should be able to see certain focal areas of chondrobenzoideles, which is very important one to give. So presence of chondromyxoid stroma is very important one, man. And even in the myoepithelioma, as I've already told you that we have only myoepithelial component, so there won't be any typical chondromyxoid stroma. And one more thing is the melting type of growth pattern is not evident. A swarm of bees appearance, which is typically seen in pleomorphic adenomas. And one more important thing is in cellular adenomas, yes, exactly, we will have a cellularity, ductal component will be less, but in myoepithelioma, it will be very, very reminiscent. It will be less than 5%. We can see very few ducts.
Just of it, in myoepithelioma, we see myoepithelial cells, whereas in cellular pleomorphic adenoma, a dual proliferation of population of cells will be seen.
Exactly.
Thank you, Pawan. I think Selvi has got the answer. So the next question is by Dr. Osmani. He wants to know about the tuberalial salivary glands. Where are they located? What is their anatomic structure? And what type of secretion do they produce? Tuberalial salivary glands.
The tuberalial salivary glands are usually located in the oropharynx, nasopharynx, at a place called torus tubaris. This is a recent advance in salivary gland. It has been explored during some radiotherapy. Dr. Vogel in September 2020 has published this article in radiotherapy and oncology. And there is the question is very interesting. The irate. What is the role of radiation, radiotherapy in this? We have to, what their study says is avoid irradiation of the glands to prevent the side effects of the radiotherapy. That is what we have known about this. And there's infrared, there's one more question that has been put forward by Dr. Usmani, I suppose. That is about some light, which is an infrared light, which enhances the regeneration and to help the regeneration of the any tissues or tumor during the phases of resolution and the inflammation or the injury. So this is what we know about the new salivary glands.
To add to what Dr. Nandan has told, these tuberial salivary glands, they are mainly located in the nasopharynx and oropharynx. They mainly help in lubrication and swallowing, and they are mixed in nature. And regarding the next question, what do you think about the regeneration of salivary glands with photobiomodulatory therapy after treatment with radiation in head and neck cancer? So this is also asked by Dr. Osmani. So a few points have been added by Nandan.
Dr. Anuradha, very frankly speaking, I have no idea for this particular regeneration, but what this particular question has been posed there is, will that be the photo light, which is talking about the infrared light, which enhances the repair and regeneration? I have no idea about salivary gland regeneration after radiotherapy. So frankly speaking, because we are not aware of this particular treatment, which it is not being done in our place. So we have no idea about this regeneration and repair of this particular after the radiotherapy, that particular infrared light has been placed for regeneration of the salivary gland. That is what
is Dr. Nandan says he doesn't have any exposure to those research, but the literature has suggested that after photobiomodulatory therapy, that is exposure to diode radiation for about 3 days per week during the course of radiation, it improves the salivary flow. So thereby, It increases the quality of life of post radiation. It increases the quality of life of the patient. So that is about the question. The next question is, what is the cell of origin of secretory cell carcinoma? Dr. Pawan?
We can hear you.
I think at this point, Dr. Priya, you can also join in so we can have the discussion all at once.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah.
Okay. Secretory cell carcinoma, though it is given recently by WHO, it says that carcinoma which is not arising from the salivary gland origin, it can be from other than salivary gland origin, it can be skin or lip or gland, thyroid gland. So origin is not clear, but it can be from the reserve cells which on signaling there is proliferation. So that is, it's not known, but it is not from, it could be one of from the reserve cells or stem cells.
Thank you, Dr. Yan. Now, I think the question is answered. Diaphyblic acidic protein, GFAP expression, is a true expression shown by myoepithelial cells, or it's a parasympathetic neural component present peripherally to the acini? GFAP expression, is it a true expression by the tumor cells, or is it a parasympathetic neural component present peripheral to the acini?
I think we can't hear Dr. Pawan. Must be some problem there. Any of you want to chip in? I think the connection must be off.
GFAP expression is carried out for benign and malignant tumors. The pattern of expression varies. The peripheral expression is seen in acinic cell carcinoma, whereas intratumoral diffuse expression is seen in pleomorphic adenoma. And even in PLGA, the expression is evident, but peripheral expression is more in acinic cell carcinoma. That's the differentiating point.
Yes. That was by Dr. Priya. The tumor cells as such, they express the diaphyblic acidic protein. Any other questions?
Another, can you come again, please?
Yeah, the question was diaphyblic acidic protein expression. Is it a true expression by the myoepithelial cells, or is it by the parasympathetic nerves present close to the acini?
It won't be a true presentation, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. That's what Priya ma'am told.
Yeah, thank you.
Have we gone through all the questions?
Yes, ma'am. We have done the questions.
Okay. Thank you so much. Thank you, Dr. Anuradha. That was very nice and nicely done. Okay, I'll just go through some of the people who joined us. Rather, I could not read that time. Dr. Vivek Gupta, and I had asked the postgrads to tell us where they are joining from and if they are postgrads. So we have Dr. Chakra Pani, who is from CKS Dental College. Then we have Dr. Neda Karduni, Dr. Bhargavi from GSL Dental College, Dr. Sharon Priyanka, S.J. Desi from, I don't know, where, must be St. Joseph's Dental College.
Right? Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, okay. And Dr. Shankar, Dr. Apurva Chelikani. Okay, I'm sorry if I'm messing up some of these names. Please forgive me. Okay, and so also from St. Joseph's Dental College, of course, Dr. Selvi is there, and Dr. Shankar, who is from Belgaum, Maratha Mandal. Okay, that's close to home. In fact, very close to my home. And then there is, of course, Dr. Navya Hadassa from, again, St. Joseph's. And, oh, how nice. Hazare sir also is with us. Good morning, sir. Thank you for joining in. And he does say well done to both of you.
Thank you,
Dr. Nandini says very nice cases. Dr. HKM, who asked the question. Dr. Varsha asked the question, which we answered.
The last question has to be answered.
Yeah, I was just saying, yes, please take that.
Nandan, in oncocytoma case, you had kept the oncocytic hyperplasia as the differential diagnosis. Can you clarify your final diagnosis of oncocytoma? Pavan, this is for you.
Yes, ma'am. We our final diagnosis, we gave it as oncocytoma only, because the oncocytosis, which is a reactive lesion, so where we predominantly we will see a normal salivary gland tissue in oncocytosis. Only in focal areas we can see the proliferation of the oncocytes, but that won't be the case in oncocytoma. It will be usually sheets of oncocytes which we'll be seeing, and areas of the normal salivary gland tissue will be less. So that is a very important difference we have to understand between oncocytoma and oncocytosis, because that makes the diagnosis different as well as the prognosis.
Yeah. Yes. Sir has explained about how we are differentiated between hyperplasia and oncocytoma. Thus, that clarifies your doubt, I think, Sakshi.
Yes.
Next week.
Okay, I think we are done with the questions. Anything Dr. Priya or you, Dr. Anuradha, would want to add in to sum it up?
I'll be very happy, Dr. Priya, if you sum it up.
So, it was a good overview of the clinical, the classification of salivary gland tumors, and also nice photomicrograph of the various cases. Thought of just adding one thing here, since you spoke about TNM staging with regard to salivary gland tumors. The concept of dedifferentiation in salivary gland tumors was spoken about. And so it is actually the progression of cells towards the less differentiation state, where it can lead to the lymph node metastasis and recurrence and metastasis, which is little unusual for the salivary gland tumors. So now they use a better term like high-grade transformation. So with regard to that, the treatment can vary, though the staging system is not there. I mean, it is not taken into consideration. Considering the lymph node metastasis and recurrence rate and all that, the treatment can vary. So I thought I'll just add that point, the concept of dedifferentiation or high-grade transformation in salivary gland tumors.
The complexity of the salivary gland tumors is that only we cannot really put the TNM properly there.
Yes.
So that staging, and if not staging and all that, there should not be grading. What is happening here is they could have utilized some other markers. There's a specific which. There would have been some narration about that. That's what I felt. Narration has not been done by the WHO, and the differentiation has been. What happens? The polymorphous low-grade adenocarcinoma has become polymorphous adenocarcinoma now. The confusion arises if I get a very small lesion, a small specimen, then we have to think.
Sir, and the first case of pleomorphic adenoma, you showed about the adipose component in the tumor. Just thought of adding this point. So that lipomatous pleomorphic adenoma is a separate entity, where subtype of pleomorphic adenoma, where 90% of the tumoral tissue should have adipose differentiation. But in other pleomorphic adenoma, we can see some amount of adipose tissue, just for the postgraduates, so that they can type it. They can't type it as a lipomatous pleomorphic adenoma unless there is 90% tumor tissue comprising of adipose.
Yes, that is true. Thank you for that addition. You know, this differentiation in the salivary gland tumors, I think, is something that we could take a 1 hour talk only on that. And it is in a way what makes salivary gland neoplasm so fascinating. The more you learn about it, the more you realize you don't know. You know, it's one of those things.
Exactly.
It's amazing, but it's very interesting. Yes, totally interesting. So this was really, really very nice. Thank you. And anyone else wants to comment on anything? Or should we be wrapping it up? Okay, I guess we'll wrap it up. But everyone, please stay right till the end. I have an interesting announcement. So don't just run away as soon as this is done. One more thing is, today we have a student with us all the way from Kashmir, Dr. Afrin Nadaf. That's nice. And Dr. Vidya from Siber Institute of Dental Sciences, Guntur. So good. We had a good number of students with us, and that was generally what it is for. So now I will just have to do one more share. Give me a second. Yes. So thank you to both of you for doing this. It was a very well done lecture. It's yes, I hope you can see that.
There are some technical hiccups. Pardon from my side, ma'am. Please pardon us for that. There are technical hiccups which beyond our limit. So that is.
Yes, I have realized that these technical hiccups happen much as one tries, and which is now why I have at least one or two other people with me. So if anything happens to the speakers, they can take over, you know. So this is you can't help it. You have to sometimes. What I like to say is you have to people-proof technology, and this is the best we can do. But all said and done, there was not a big glitch. It was all good. And thank you so much. And I hope that you will be having some more presentations on the channel. So thank you. And
thank you so much. Thank you so much.
I also have one little certificate for Dr. Anuradha and for all her help, which actually was called in rather last minute because we were supposed to have Dr. Ravikant with us today, and due to some personal reasons, he couldn't join. So she was kind enough. She's kind enough actually to just step in. And interestingly enough, I think this is the first time I have met Dr. Anuradha. So it was really nice working with you on this. Hopefully we'll do more together.
I'm sure, ma'am. Thank you for the opportunity.
You're most welcome. And yes, so coming to the announcements. First and foremost, next week is not going to be a live session. Next week, as we know, the Tuesday is our Indian Republic Day, and for that we are going to have a Republic Day special. I will not tell you much about it. It will be a recorded version, but it will go live, or it will come online at 11 o'clock as usual. So please make it a point to watch it for a few minutes. It will not be the regular 1 hour, it will be much shorter. I'll be very happy if you can watch it and leave your comments as you do see it and tell me what you think of the idea. And of course, this I have announced it last week too. We have an upcoming international one-day case presentation webinar, which will be on the 21st of Feb. It will be a morning to evening. It's a Sunday. It's for early career. So essentially anybody less than 8 years of experience. The idea is really to give our younger colleagues a chance to present. Normally that doesn't happen till later in their career. So this is, I'm hoping that all departments will gear up and, you know, help the youngsters to present. More details of this will be up within the next few days as to how you can do the presentation, what sort of cases are required, and how to go about it. Now, the other announcement I had, which I requested you to stay for. As you know, this whole program has been going on so far, essentially with presentations, either by people who are so close to me, so I knew that they will not say no, or by people who love oral pathology so much, so I knew they would not say no. So they have all agreed. And in fact, even for the next 2 or 3 months, we have programs already scheduled. But I think it's now time to take it beyond the people that I know. So I'm going to start accepting proposals from anybody who thinks they have a topic they love very much, they are passionate about, and they would want to share. And with that, so send me your proposals if you feel you have a topic that can come on the channel. And this is not only for our friends in India, this is international. If you are in our own time zone, we will fit it on the Tuesday program. If you are in a time zone that cannot be fitted easily within the 11 o'clock on Tuesday mornings as per the Indian Standard Time, then we also have a once a month international Beyond the Borders series like we just had with Professor Keat, who gave a wonderful presentation on CEOT. It was so complete that I don't think anybody needs to read anything else. You just listen to that and that's that. So if you have any such thoughts, any such ideas, please send me the proposals. I will definitely go through them. And there are no limitations in any way. You don't have to be an academician. You don't have to be anything specific as long as you have an idea within oral pathology that will benefit others. I would love to share those ideas and I would love to have you on the program. So with that, and of course, with a special thank you to Dr. Bhavna, who's been helping us today from behind the scenes on YouTube. And with that, I would like to say bye to everyone. Have a wonderful week. And we'll see you, not live, but on a recorded version next week. Thank you so much. Lovely having you all here. And before you go away, please, if you have enjoyed this program, if you support this whole movement, please hit the subscribe button. Thank you. See you all again soon.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye, Nandan.
Thank you, ma'am. Bye, ma'am.
Bye.